share with your friends too as well. Today we are looking at yet another interesting topic about the Akzumite people. In our last discussion, we looked at the achievement of the Akzumite people, and I am very much sure and confident that whenever you are asked any question about the Akzumite people, you will, I mean, concerning their achievement, you will be able to write or tell someone. Now, today we are looking at the synthetic theory, the introduction of Christianity into Axum and its effect. So, how did Christianity enter into Axum and what was the effect of this introduction? And I want to state that, of course, Christianity came into Axum way around the 4th century BC, before the Europeans came to Africa, or the Portuguese came to West Africa to reintroduce Christianity. So, I mean, what the Portuguese only did was to reintroduce their religion, but they did not introduce the religion, because the religion was already in Ethiopia or on the African soil before the Europeans came. So let's take a look at our lesson objectives. By the end of the lesson, you should be able to know two things. One, discuss ways in which Christianity entered into action, and then two, should be able to examine the effects of the introduction of Christianity into action. So, what were the effects? How did Christianity enter into action? These are the two things that I expect you to know after the end of the lesson. So, let's quickly move to the introduction of Christianity into action. How did Christianity enter into action? But before Christianity entered into action, note that the Akzumite people were worshipping many gods, and therefore we can assume that they were polytheistic in nature. They worshipped many gods. Example of such gods is Astar, Meher, and then Peher. These were some of the gods that the Akzumite people worshipped, and we want you to find out the functions of these gods. You can Google them and you get the function of each of the gods that the Akzumite people worship. And therefore, whenever you knew or you wanted something, you knew the kind of god that you would go to in order to get that. Now, let's continue. Let's take a look at how did Christianity enter into Akzumite. Now, Christianity was introduced to the Akzumite people in 333 AD. And it was introduced by a young Syrian Christian known as Frumentius. Okay, and Frumentius is said, according to oral tradition, it is said that Frumentius and his brother Adiosis, okay, they were involved in a shipwreck. They were on a high seas in a ship, and unfortunately for them, they were involved in a shipwreck. The ship got sunk into the sea, and they were the only survivors who, of course, survived the whole shipwreck. And therefore, the two brothers were rescued on the coast, on the Ethiopian coast. Their ship got wrecked on the Ethiopian coast, and the two brothers were rescued by the Akzumite people, and they were handed over to the king of Akzum called Ella Amida. And Ella Amida, who was then the king of Akzum, made these two brothers, Frumentius, his steward, and Adiosis, his cupbearer. And of course, as time went on, King Ella died. And therefore, the queen made the two brothers, Frumentius and Adiosis, to rule Axum. And she, or the queen, then became the co-regent. Now, Frumentius then took advantage of this rare opportunity for a foreigner to just be made a king, to build what Christian churches for Roman merchants that he visited, who came to visit Axum. So Axum was in constant trade with the Romans who came to visit. So they built churches or monasteries for them. Now, in his attempt to recruit a bishop for Axum, of course, after building the churches, Frumentius then needed a bishop or somebody who would head the Ethiopian church or the Axumite church. And therefore, he went to Egypt, the church of Alexandria. And at that time, Egypt was the seat of Christianity. Even across the whole world, Egypt was highly Christianized. And he went to a certain man called Saint Denasus, and as Denasus was the patriarch of the Alexandria Church. So he went to him and demanded for a bishop to be appointed by the patriarch, Saint Athanasius, so that he could head the Asmonean Church or the Ethiopian Church. And of course, Saint Athanasius then appointed Frumentius as the bishop of Asmonean. Okay, and therefore, of course, Frumentius, who introduced Christianity to Asmonean, then also became the first bishop of the Asmonean or the Ethiopian Church. And the first king of the Ethiopians or the Asmonean people to be converted to Christianity was King Ezana. And after his conversion, King Ezana then made Christianity the state god. The images you see there is the image of Frumentius. First one is the image of Frumentius. And then some of the churches or monasteries that God he built. And then King Ezana is the one with the spear and gun over there. And then we also have the ship that got wrecked. And as a result of that, Frumentius and his brother got into action. Now quickly, let's take a look at some of the effects of the introduction of Christianity into action. I think that Christianity led to a deep bond with the Coptic Church in Egypt. So because of the appointment of Frumentius as the Bishop of Antony, you know, Frumentius came to adopt a lot of the doctrine of the Coptic Church in Egypt. And don't forget that Christianity is made up of different doctrines, with different people believing in different doctrines. They say Christian, but they will say, I don't believe in that, I believe in that, and all of that. And so because of this, the two state churches became closely and deeply bound in respect of doctrine and church organization. So how they organize their church? If you go to the Alexandria Church of Egypt, the way they organize their church, probably the mass rest, the correction, the this, the that, all of the nature how church is organized in the church or in the room, that is the same way the Ethiopians also copy that from the Egyptian churches, and also doctrines, what the Egyptian church believed in. And so we have seen that there was a deep bond between the Coptic Church in Egypt. And as a result of this, we are saying that the Ethiopian church was sometimes referred to as the Coptic Church of Ethiopia. And the Coptic Church was only in Egypt. But here we also got to refer to the Ethiopian church as the Coptic Church of Egypt, mainly because of how they all had similar doctrine and church organization. Now, as a result of this connection, monastic ideas sprang up in Ethiopia, especially in northern Ethiopia. So, monasteries were buildings or church buildings that were built, and monks. When you look at those people over there, they are termed as monks. Check for the meaning of monk, and you will really understand who these people were. They were people who had accepted themselves to live for Christ. They won't marry, they won't bath, they won't do anything. All what they do is to wake up early in the morning, read the Bible, and preach the gospel of God. And so this monastic idea, sprang in Ethiopia as a result of their belief with the Coptic Church in Egypt. Let's take a look at the second one. Christianity led to the spread of missionary activities. So prior to the introduction, there wasn't anything about missionary activities. Now, the monks took to themselves to spread the Christian faith, and it increased the spread of missionary activities. So the adoption of Christianity as a state religion inspired the monks of the Ethiopian church to embark upon missionary activities. Many of the monks moved into areas outside the control of Asmonean kings to convert several people. So these monks did not only restrict themselves to Ethiopia, but then also they moved further outside Ethiopia to also spread the gospel. And some of the towns that they moved are what we have there. We have Kaffa, we have Enaya, we also have Tanjiro. And of course, these were some of the towns that were outside, of course, Ethiopia, that these monks spread the gospel. Now, added to all these were the pilgrims made by the Asmonean Christians to Jerusalem, regularly to obtain spiritual guidance and inspiration. And therefore, pilgrimages to Jerusalem, the holy city of the Christian faith, was also became something that the king's monks were interested in. So you realize that during this time, after the spread of Christianity into Asia by Prometheus, there was this increase in missionary activities. And I hope you are clear with these 2 points. Let's take a look at the next 2 points as we move on. Now, Christianity also led to the military means of spreading the gospel. Military means. And the introduction of Christianity in Acts 4, the kings of Acts adopt military methods to spread the gospel. For instance, the southern kingdoms of Ulamu was conquered and incorporated into Ethiopia. That the territorial expansion of Ethiopia during this era was as a result of the determination of the kings and Christian priests to convert several people to Christianity. So don't forget that in history, it is not only the Islamic faith that has resorted to the use of force or war in the propagation of their gospel. The Christians in the Middle Ages at this time also had soldiers known as crusaders. They also call themselves the Jesus. These people, as you see there, if you've been watching movies with these kind of people, they have their shield and there is a cross on their shield. They will have a flag with their cross. These people were also responsible for spreading the gospel, and they were spreading it through military, what it means. They use force, so they conquer you, and then they force all of you to become Christians. And we are saying that as a result of the introduction of Christianity into Axum, what happened was that the territorial space of Axum or Ethiopia expanded, and it was all because the kings of Ethiopia wanted to conquer neighboring countries or neighboring people in order to make them Christians at all costs. Good. Now let's then take a look at the occupational skills. Christianity also led to occupational skills in Ethiopia. Another major effect of the introduction of Christianity in Axum was the spread of the knowledge of craftwork, architecture, and farming. They also introduced other occupational and technical skills such as gold and silver working, as well as weaving, which spread in the south. And so, occupationally, Christianity also led to some form of work that it came with. And you can, if you know your history well, in Ghana, for instance, the introduction of Christianity also led to, you know, the establishment of some technical schools to give the people some sort of skill, okay? Yes, and this is some of the, occupational skills or work was craftwork, architecture, farming, and weaving, and all of that. Technical skills in using gold and silver to work, and all of that. So this was, of course, the reason for the effect of Christianity in action. And I hope you are also clear with these 2 points. Let's take a look at the last point concerning the introduction of action. The last one. Now, Christianity also brought a new era of peace and the introduction of new administrative systems into Ethiopia. Okay, a new era of peace where everything was. Now, let's take a look at this. The adoption of Christianity in Axum brought a new era of peace in Ethiopia. Prior to the advent of Christianity in the south, religious intolerance prevailed, and this was expressed through persecution of people. But when Christianity became widespread, peace prevailed, and all religious persecution ended. As Christianity became a state religion, the authority of the kings was enhanced. So you realize that before the introduction of Christianity, everyone was, belonged to some sort of beliefs, and this normally resulted in religious persecution. People were persecuted for their religious beliefs, especially the southern part of Ethiopia. Okay, and but when Christianity became a state religion, now the emperor or the king made Christianity a state religion, and therefore you had no option than to become a Christian. And so all the people in Ethiopia now came to belong to a particular or a one religion, one faith, and therefore it of course will stop the persecution and it will lead towards peace. This is how Christianity led to peace in Axum. Not only peace, but also new administrative system, how the people organize themselves. In the south, a common administrative system was put in place His administrative system was characterized by an elaborate judicial as well as financial arrangement. State councils were also introduced and new offices created in an attempt to ensure effective and efficient governance. So Christianity again led to the effective and efficient governance of the Ethiopian society. And as we are saying, that elaborate judiciary and financial arrangements were all made in each in Axum. And all these came as a result of the introduction of Christianity into Axum. Okay, now that you have collected this, let's take a look at yesterday. Last one, I guess. Another effect of Christianity in Axum was that Christianity led to the development of literature. Okay, and literature also flourished in Ethiopia when Christianity was introduced. The introduction of Christianity brought with it a system of learning. Among other things, the Bible and other Christian texts were translated into Greek. The Greek language was enriched by the introduction of new words to express new Christian ideas, such as exabo, which means God. So, you know, you can't, well, I don't want to say you can't, but you can't be illiterate and say you are a Christian if I am right, because Christianity comes with it a type of learning. That is the more reason why if you look at Ghana, for instance, it was the Europeans the missionaries who started with education, because they realized that you need to read the Bible in order to understand the religion. And here, to do the same thing, Christianity, we are saying, brought with it type of what learning. Because you needed to read the Bible. And the Bible was then translated into the Greek language. And we know where the Greek language came from, as we talked about it in our previous meeting. And therefore, certain words, again, you know, were borrowed, as we know of the Greek language, being borrowed, you know, words mixed with Serbian, whatever. And so, Christianity came with its new form of words, learning, and it is true. Even here, we experience that. Another work in literature which became important was the Kebra Negasti, the Glory of Kings, and which was an attempt to trace the origins of the kings of Ethiopia to the Israelite kings. So this famous literature or book, which was written, titled Kebra Negasti, and in English is called the Glory of Kings. What happened was that the Ethiopians tried to train their kings to that of the Israelite kings, claiming that their kings might have descended from the tribe of David or the line of David. Let's take a look at that. The kings were believed to be the descendants of King Solomon and the Queen of Sheba in biblical records. So in the Kebra Negasti, it wrote or it is found that the kings of Axum or Ethiopia are descendants of Solomon and Queen Sheba. And we all know what happened between Queen Solomon and Sheba when Sheba went to visit Solomon upon hearing of how King Solomon was, his wisdom. An Ethiopian tradition spoke of the Queen of Sheba, who was an Ethiopian ruler. She was said to have traveled to Jerusalem to study the great wisdom of King Solomon. Incidentally, she got married to King Solomon and gave birth to a son who later on succeeded the throne of Ethiopia as Menelik I. It was for this reason that the Solomonic dynasty came to be associated with the Axumite civilization. So, in the Kebra Negasti, which came as a result of the introduction of Christianity, it is stated that King Solomon or the kings of Axum are descendants of Solomon and Sheba. And Sheba, as we said, went to Solomon, and at the point they got married and they gave birth to Queen Menelik. And it is believed by the Ethiopians or the Axumite that Menelik was the first Ethiopian emperor. Okay, and therefore Menelik then, of course, from the line of Menelik, they gave birth to other, you know, kings and so they trace their origin to, and that is why a dynasty, we shall look at them later, known as the Solomonic dynasty. Like a ruling clan, in a sense, you say the corner clan or whatever. So this is the ruling clan, the Solomonic dynasty. If you didn't believe in this dynasty, of course, you were not part of the dynasty. Of course, you could not do. And so these, our six or so, are effect of Christianity in action. And I am very hopeful and confident that whenever you are asked anywhere to talk about the effect of Christianity and how Christianity enters into action, you will not disappoint me. But before we end the lesson, I have some pictures for you, a surprise for you, so that you get to have a feel of how the Ethiopian church looked like. Now, the Ethiopian church, if you have time, follow on the net, and you will find out that their church organization and everything is far different from the normal Christian church organization that you know. Look at this picture. This is the Ethiopian church. This is the Ethiopian church. Look at them. Take your time and look at them. Google on the internet, and I bet you will find videos of some of these, and you realize that their church is somehow different. Their organization, their costume, and everything is different. So some images of Ethiopian Christians. And today, Ethiopians are still Christians. And they have been Christianized since the 4th century. And they were not Christianized by Europeans. Their names are even in the Bible, Abyssinia. Their names are dead. The descendants who started the whole civilization. So, since you have, I know you are done with the images, so let me give you your try work. Try and look at that. Now, we have a question here, a past question, which says that highlight any three social effects of the introduction of Christianity on the people of Axum, as we have looked at. So, it was the May, June 2013 question. Then, May, June 2014, the following year, they asked the same question, I guess, take any four effects of the introduction of Christianity on Ethiopia. So they are already trying to be smart, so we should also be smart. I hope and I am confident that today you have enjoyed our lesson. We shall meet again some other time. Subscribe to the page and also try to recommend it to a friend. Bye-bye.